right near the Oak Edge. They said they started a skyscraper job.
Here it is. Pixar. So what kind of stuff are you doing right now? Still doing the same thing? You gotta fix the name. That's what you were seeing when we were working on it this week? Can you put, oh, it's got the date on. Oh, I see. I'm on. Hey, fix that right there. That's ugly. We can't have ugly online. They make us look like Ned and the Third Reader. You know what that is? Go, Ned. Run. Run, Ned. Run. You don't remember that when you were a little bitty kid?
Sally, Dick, and Jane.
Yeah. Yeah. Spot. See, spot, run.
Get hit by a truck.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I was working.
Run, run, run. Sorry. Hello there.
Hi there.
I'm glad.
This has sound on it, by the way. It'll be playing. And that's what he's going to show you. There's a pause in there somewhere he wants to do. Now,
okay.
This is...
On the dedication thing, it's going to be right at the very beginning. And whenever it starts... I mean, I'm going to go up there and say a few things, and then when it's time for the video, you'll start doing the video. But as it goes through, it's going to get to a point, and it'll automatically change the slides until it gets to the parents' vow, and then it's going to stop. The music is going to continue, so the music needs to be turned down so
they can do the vows.
And then you'll have to manually click it for the rest of what's in there. There's like four slides after that.
So when you get to the vows, that's where you got to pause.
Yeah.
Pause for a minute, or
no? You just I've got it set where you just have to hit the down switch, and it'll automatically go to the next one.
That's confusing.
Okay. Yes.
Well, everything's automatic until you get back when it says parents' vow.
Okay.
Then after that, you just set it to
the. So when you get to parents' vow, you want us to stop it?
No.
For this child,
I
have prayed,
and you have. But then you will manually have to change lines after that. But you're going to have to turn the music.
For this baby,
I
have faith,
but leave it
and
on
you
a little
gave
bit.
Hey, Roy.
Moment, now I pray.
I hope so. I don't know.
And I vow to you this day.
Thank you. No problem.
This is just advertisements for classes that'll just continually loop. You know, I don't know how many are going. I guess a lot of people are coming on or whatever. And that's the countdown. Yeah. I'm going to figure out a way that we can do slides and just drop a countdown on them. And I got part of it done this week, but I just ran out of time. Mine is, looks like it's long, but it's just a lot of one line stuff.
Yeah, a lot of
stuff.
That's what I wanted to look and see. Is any of them like last week where I have to keep pushing down? And
yes,
stuff?
Like okay. This right here. So
this was, you know, I was kind of
each,
on
yeah, head. Each slide just comes on, like when I get Velocin, boom, that one comes on. This one right here, when I say Jesus is trying to tell us that every soul is precious, boom, that one goes. Now I'll show you the difference that I did this time. Harsh, go to harsh request.
Yeah, that's where I was just at. I was checking it.
Okay, so when you get to heart, it just comes on like that, right? So then look right here. Then when I get down to it was selfish, you can click, and it goes to the next one. And then when I get down here, hard reality comes on, but you're gonna need, when you get on down, see, that's just, it looks like a lot, but it's really not. See, and then on harsh reality, you'll click the next animation, right? Sends price.
That's what was going last week. I was looking at it.
I know. I didn't do that right. I didn't do it right.
I was like, oh, well.
This will make it a lot easier.
I was trying to read ahead, so I knew when you said key words that I knew what
I realized. I was like, oh, I said, hi, Debbie.
So sorry about that. Like I said, I was trying to read ahead and look for key words.
This one, this is the funny one. Go on down and just keep going. One more. And don't touch anything. One, two, three. So if you click it again, it won't work. So once you start it, you just have to leave it.
I got you.
Learn how to party. Okay. Merry Christmas. Here's your notes. I'll do better this week.
Right.
You know, I've been out of the habit of preaching for a long time. And it takes a lot to get
back into it.
Yes. Such a mental game. Hi, Timo.
Hey, you got a live mic back here. It's going out over the...
This one?
I don't know. You have a live mic.
You hear it?
Yeah, it's all live.
Hello? How about that?
Yeah.
How, you remember that girl? Cash me a sigh. How about that?
Yeah.
You remember that? She was a mess. Okay.
Thank you.
Good morning. Everybody come on in and find you a chair. It's good to see everyone here this morning. Got several visitors. We're glad that you are here. So if the elders will come on up front, I'd appreciate it. Today is our baby dedication day, and we are excited. This is our chance to share, we want you to know how much we appreciate you, and we want you to know as parents that you mean something to us. We want to be involved in helping you raise your child. We want to be there whenever you are in need or in hurt or in celebration. We want you to feel at home in a part. So, are we all here? Are we all sunshiny faces? We're all in our places. Tyson and Felicia here. They're at the Batfish? Oh, I thought they wanted to take the tour. That's a very good tour, by the way. Timing's not really good, but hey, that's all right. Hey, Amy, can we sing a song while we wait for them to arrive? I kind of thought you could do that for us. Nah, I'm sorry.
All right. Let's take a minute to pray. Let's settle ourselves. How's that sound? Let's take the chaos and rein it in. Baby dedication day is exciting. Exciting, exciting. Let's go to the Father in prayer. God, we love you so much. We thank you for every day. We thank you for new mornings, new beginnings. We thank you for our babies, God. We thank you for these new little lives that we get to love on, God, that we get to help grow up in your word. And we are so grateful to be a part of that. We ask, God, that you just fill this room with your presence, God, and that you touch these families, that you put your hand on everyone in this room, and especially our little ones, God. We need them. We live in such a chaotic world, God. We need these babies and these kids to grow up and just introduce you into every single thing they do. God, we love you and we praise you. We worship you. We are nothing without you. We thank you so much for your spirit that just fills this room, God. I ask that you be with this service today. God, I ask that you be with our speakers, with our worship, and most of all, that we just open our hearts and let you be with each and every one of us. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. I'm crying already, you guys. We haven't even done anything. For those of you that don't know me, I'd cry at the drop of a hat. My name's Amy. You're welcome. Let's sing this a cappella since we have the words up, and then we'll just do it with the track in a little bit because this song is amazing. Do you guys want to stand and sing with us? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. And through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Amen. You can be seated.
All right. All right, we're going to begin. I want you to know that God knows Robbie and He knows Rhett very well. Because in Psalms 139, He talks about them. For You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise You because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from You when I was made in that secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in Your book. Before one of them came to be, how precious to me are Your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. And then the verse that comes to mind is in 3 John chapter 1. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. This dedication service is to let you know as parents that we are here to help you in any way as we can. I'd like to introduce y'all to some folks that you may or may not know. First of all, I would like to introduce you to Robert Andrew Hume. So, Robert, if you would stand up, or Robbie. And his mama and daddy are Tyson and Felicia. So if y'all would stand up and just come on over here, up on the stage, yeah. We'll make it as difficult as possible for you. Robbie was born November the 15th in 2001 at St. Francis here in Muskogee. Don't start that yet. Grandparents, oh, by the way, grandparents, if you don't mind, if you would come stand with your babies, I would appreciate it. So, grandparents are Dudley and Brenda Hume, and Edward and Joy Valdez. Yeah. And I asked the mamas to write a few little words about situations going on about their babies. This is what was written. Robbie has been so strong from birth. He loves to crawl, move, and laugh. Honestly, he's just the happiest baby. It doesn't take much to get him smiling. He loves to try new foods and is not one to miss a meal. Yeah. We can't say enough how blessed we are with this little guy. He brings joy to everyone that he meets. All righty. Now let me introduce you to Rhett Peyton Kramer. Rhett's sitting back there at the back. Mom and Dad are Josh and Lily. If y'all would come on up to the front. All right. Cool, cool, cool. Rhett was born December the 10th at St. Francis Muskogee as well. And grandparents, if y'all would like to come too, Glenn Kramer and Jennifer Sullins and Alan and Beth Essery. Love to have y'all come join us. And we've got a great-grandmother. We all know her as Miss Marilyn Bradford, but they call her Granny or Grandma or Grandmother, great-grandmother. And let me warn you, in just a minute, you're going to see some really cool pictures. There is a beautiful picture with her holding the baby, okay? So you're welcome to join on stage if you want, or if you would prefer to sit there and admire it, then you're welcome there too. Yeah. This is what was written down. Rhett loves his great-grandmother so much. He cries when she's not around. He thinks peekaboo is so funny. Most likely, he's always outside, swimming or swinging. He hates being inside. All boy over here. Since the day he was born, he has the biggest eyes in his very expressive looks. He always wakes up smiling and happy. He is a very happy baby. All righty. Okay. Now, the church has got a little Bible. It's the boys' first Bibles. And then we've also, if you will remember back several months ago, we asked y'all to contribute things, advice, wisdom that you think that parents, new parents, should have. And then Margaret Ramsey here, she's very talented. I don't know if y'all have realized that, but she's very gifted, and we're really blessed to have her at the office. But she compiled it, and she put together pictures and made it personalized. And so they've got a little book with your information in there about do's and don'ts and this and that. And it's really, really beautiful. So we are going to present that to them. So Tim and Jared. Yeah, it'll make you cry. Yeah. I looked at it. I didn't cry very long, but 45 minutes or so. I was okay after that. We're going to watch a few pictures. And then after that, we're going to make a vow. The parents are going to be making a vow to us as the church, and we as the church are going to be making a vow towards them. So, Jeremiah, show that fabulous bean footage.
For this child, I have prayed, and you heard my cry. For this baby, I had faith. This baby back. such a trust with this precious gift. With your power, by your love, my all I commit. On the straight and narrow way, for your purposes I say that I dedicate this baby back to you. I dedicate myself to train and love them like you do. I will do my part. I will put your word into this baby back.
As the family of God, we promise to help create an environment for those children to walk in the abundant life that Jesus offers. We promise to be faithfully to you in response to your request for help in teaching and encouraging your children in the ways of God, so that one day trust Jesus as Savior.
For this child I have prayed, and you heard my cry.
Heavenly Father, you are a wonderful
for
God.
This baby,
we are so joyful right now that you have blessed
I
us with these two new boys in this world.
And you
blessed our congregation and blessed these families. We're so happy that they are here with us. We're so happy that they are getting to experience your church and your love and your family.
And I vow to
you have blessed us with these boys, and I ask that you continue to bless these boys throughout their lives. I pray that you and Tyson and Felicia, as they raise Robbie, help him to be a strong young man who knows you and loves you and is praying for you. Expresses your love and does your will on this earth.
And love them
with Tyson and Felicia as they raise Robbie. Help them, give them encouragement, perseverance, patience, kindness, all the things that young parents need, and help them to most of them rest God whenever they can. I pray that you be with Will, Josh, and Rhett. I pray that Rhett grows strong in you, God. I pray that he knows your love, and that he knows your word, and that he lives a life that glorifies you, and that he does your will. I pray that you be with Lily and Josh. Be with them as young new parents. Also give them rest and perseverance and patience and kindness and understanding, not only of Rhett, but of each other as they raise a baby together. Bless these families, God. Help them to know that you are here, that you love them, and help most of all our congregation and the people in this room to be the hands and the mouths and the servants that you would have us to be for them. Be with our church, help them serve them, and create a community for these families to know that they can rely on us in good times and bad, when things get hard, when things are happy and fun, and when things are sick and miserable, that we are all here together, that we're all here for them. God, I pray that good health for these families, protect them and watch over them, and help us to do our part and to do your will for these boys and throughout their lives. We love you, God, and help Jesus to be glorified in all that we do. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
feels like we're like a one-act play. Like we're like moving things off and bringing things back. And next time we have to do baby dedication later because I've cried and my feelings are in my throat. Oh my gosh, these little babies. Well, I'm going to make you guys stand again because we're going to get to our song part of our worship. So let's stand and we're going to just sing our praise to God. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for being our Father, for being our Dad, for just always being there. God, we thank You that You're such a good, good Father.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think You're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love.
the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know that we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. 'Cause you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. Who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect. Father God, we come to you this morning with open hearts. God, we love you so much. God, we thank you for your mercies that are new every single day. God, we thank you for your love. We thank you that you're a good, good Father, that you sent your Son as the cornerstone, not to just everything, God, but to our lives, God, to our faith. God, help us to be obedient. Help us to trust in you, God, when times are tough. Help us to know that when we stray, God, we have you right there with us. God, we thank you for everyone in this room. I pray a special blessing on them for this week. And God, help us to be bold in our faith. Help us to go out and tell others about you. God, it's in your son's precious name that we pray. Amen. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know is your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. We crown for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know is your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy be unto your name. We are the broken, you are the healer, Jesus Redeemer, mighty to save. You are the love song we'll sing forever, bowing before you, blessing your name. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name, be unto your name. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name, be unto your name, be unto your name.
Amen. You can be seated. Would you bow with me, please? Father, holy, holy is your name. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. That says it all right there. I just pray as we start to take communion this morning that we would just be in that frame of mind only, that we would remember your Son and the sacrifice that was given as we take this juice, that everything from the outside world would just drop away, that we would just focus on the Lamb that was slain and what that means. And it is in his precious name, in the name of Jesus, that I pray this. Amen. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Would you bow with me, please? Father, as we go to take the bread that represents your son's body. It said in John that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome. Praise God that the light shines through everything. Jesus is with us in every situation, no matter how dark. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for sending your son. And our hearts break at the thought of his body breaking. But we know that this was for a reason. And we thank you for the sacrifice. Help us to remember that this day as we take this bread. And it's in his precious name that we pray. Amen.
Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Will you bow with me, please? Father, we are so thankful for everything that you have blessed us with. And we just ask as we go into our contribution today that you would bless everything that is given today, that it would be put to use to further your kingdom, and that as we go through our week, we would look for opportunities to serve others and to give where we see fit, where you would give us that nudge to give, but that you would just use our talents and our gifts that you've given to us to bless those around us. And it's in your son's name I pray. Amen.
I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Good morning. Today I'll be reading Luke 15:11-13. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them the story. A man had two sons. The younger son told the father, "I want to share my estate now before you die." So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, the younger son packed up all his belongings and moved to the distant land, and there he wasted his money in the wild living.
All right, Merrills, what time is it? For those of you that are visiting, Jam Time is Jesus and Me. It's a time for our kiddos to go, and they do fun stuff back there. They dance and sing and do all kinds of stuff. So if you're new, you can still go. Your kiddos can go to this back door, and they'll let them know which classroom to go to. Let's stand and sing our kiddos out if we can. Up, down, up, down. I know. I'm demanding. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, church. How are you? Good. Man, it's great to see all the parents and the grandparents here and loving on these babies. We like babies. Trish won't agree to this, but she told me one time, you know, if I could just stay young, I think I'd have had 12 babies. You did say that once. Do you remember? But then Brett had 4, and we thought, well, I'm glad we didn't do that. Randy Guthrie, you know Randy works for me. He's Cleo's second cousin, and his daddy died this week. Some of you saw that post. And there were 11 kids in his family. And Cleo, where are you, Cleo? Cleo said there were 10 in his. That's back in the day where you just made your own farm workers, right? And everybody grew up plowing and picking cotton and whatever you had to do. I think he was he 84? Oh, I think that's right. Bill was 84. Anyway, is that right? Yeah. And, you know, it's amazing when you lose your daddy. How many of you here have gone through this experience of losing your daddy? Wow. That's pretty amazing. It's a painful deal. And we're going to look at these stories. Today's the third one in God's Lost and Found department from Luke 15. You might want to turn there because we're going to read this story here in just a second. It's a lengthy one, but I got to thinking about it. We need to read it because anytime you say something like, well, it would take up too much time to read the Word of God, then that's a big slap in the face, isn't it? So we're going to look at that today. Now, we've looked at a couple of stories that were just pretty amazing in their own, but we're going to look at the backstory here just a little bit. All the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to Jesus to listen to him. He had something to say. There's two types of people in the world. You already know this. Those that have something to say, and those that just have to say something. Well, Jesus is the one that had something to say, and so both the Pharisees and the scribes began complaining about this, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. To receive a sinner means bring him into your own just like family. Well, they couldn't stand this. You know, it just upset them so bad. So we've looked at these stories, and today we're going to look at the story of the lost son. Jesus is placing greater and greater emphasis on things that are lost with each story. And I don't know if you noticed this or not, but let's talk about the lost sheep. That was the first one. My shirt, thank you, Jan. I was the one of the 100 that was lost. Okay? So you think about it, 1 out of 100. Jackson, you're going to school, all college boy and everything. What is the percentage of 1 from 100? One percent. Now, that was good. I love you, buddy. So 1%, and you might think, well, that's pretty insignificant. Well, the Pharisees probably thought it was insignificant, but to the owner of the sheep, what'd he think? Is precious, and that's why Jesus told that story from his perspective. Then the second story he tells is the story of the lost silver or the lost coin. She had 10. 1 out of 10 would be... Ten percent, that's right. 10%. So the value of the things lost, okay, we're increasing, right? Now we get to the story of the lost son. There's two boys. One of them is lost, one of them's at home. What's the percentage of that? 50%. So the things that are lost are getting of more value. Now, what he's doing is he's bringing these guys along. See, a little bit at a time. All right, 1%. I know that's not a lot. 10%. Would you like to lose 10%? No. 50%. Is that getting you? But the reality of it was, and we'll see next week on the lost sibling, it was 100%. Because both boys were lost. We're going to talk about that, and I think that you'll get it. So the things that are going in importance and in value are obvious. So what Jesus is really saying is that every soul is precious, even yours. Now, you've been in life long enough to know that there's times that you don't feel very precious, and you certainly don't feel like God loves you, And you certainly don't think that you're important enough that God would die just for you. Been there, done that. But that's wrong thinking. And we're going to correct a lot of that today, hopefully, as we look at how we feel about ourselves. Let's look into this passage and let's consider this together. Turn with me to Luke 15. We're going to read this real quickly and keep your finger there because you're going to put some notes in there. All right, Luke 15, we're going to start in verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. When he had divided his wealth between them, not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together, and he went on a journey to a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. And now when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be in need. He went and he attached himself to one of the citizens of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he was longing to fill his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving him anything to eat. And when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I'm dying here with hunger? I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Law. Did you catch it? No longer worthy. And you got to know this is a slap in the face of the Pharisees, who everything they did was about law. So watch in the story and you'll see some of that in here. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. And he got up and he came to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him. And he ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, interruptingly, I put that in there. Quickly bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let's eat and be merry. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and he's been found. And they begin to make merry. And this older son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard all the music and dancing. He summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what this might be. And he said, your brother has come and your father has killed the fattened calf because he's received him back safe and sound. Received. What was it that the Pharisees accused Jesus of? Receiving those people unto himself. Jesus uses a lot of words in this story on purpose for the audience that's hearing it, which is the scribes and the Pharisees. All right, you with me? He came angry and not willing to go in, and his father came out and began entreating him. And he said to his father, look, I don't think you should ever start out a sentence with your daddy with the word look or look here. For so many years I've been serving you, and I've never neglected a command of yours, and yet you've never given me a kid or a fatted calf or even a goat. You didn't even give me a goat. I might be merry with my friends. But when this son of yours, underline that, came, who has devoured your wealth with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, my child, you've always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to be merry and rejoice, for this brother of yours, opposed to the son of yours. You catching this? This will be good next week. You just have to wait. He was dead and begun to live. He was lost and now he has been found. Okay. This was a harsh, harsh request. Father, give me the estate that you owe me. It was shocking. I mean, it's like he was saying, I wish you were dead. I wish you had no more control over my life. Now, look here. I was a teenager a long, long time ago, and I can remember having those feelings that I didn't want my parents telling me anything. Any of you been there, done that? Every one of y'all down here with the down to see. Yeah, and I mean, that's just pretty normal, right? But it's pretty immature. But the reality of it is, it's very shocking. I wish you were dead. How about this one? Since I'm going to get this anyway when you die, let me have it now because you're just not dead soon enough. Ooh. How about this one? I'm tired of you. I want to be free from you and your control in my life. Man, I could never say that to my daddy. Did anybody ever kind of get slapped from saying something like that when you were young? The last spanking I got, you boys need to remember this. How old are y'all? 13. That was me. Man, I mouthed off something harsh to my mother. My dad heard it. He said, come in here, son. Now, do y'all know LV? He was 6'2", and he always wore, when he wasn't going to church, he wore a leather hand-tooled belt and had a big old Longhorn, go Longhorns, belt buckle. Boomer. What has happened to y'all? Longhorns. Boomer. Cowboys. Okay. He peeled that thing off and he wrapped the buckle around his hand. You know, he wasn't abusive. He said, put your hands on the bed. And he wore me out for talking to my mama that way. Man, the father, he didn't say or do anything. According to Deuteronomy 21 and verse 17, he was entitled to 1/3 of his father's estate. His request was legal. He could make that request at any time. But I think it may have been the attitude with which he delivered that request. Now, this is really a believable story because he goes and he lives his life as if his father is dead. So that was in his mind. I'm going to do what I want to do. You're sitting right here guilty of this thinking. You've done it and I've done it. I'm going to go have a party. I'm going to do what I want to do, dadgummit. I don't know where that word came from, but that's the only cuss word I could say when I was little. And it was also selfish. Give me was focused on me. His life was all wrapped up in himself, probably before he ever left home. He didn't really care for anybody. He was kind of a spoiled rich kid, you get the figure. Especially he didn't care for his father because he was in that rebellious state. But this father was so gracious, and so the Bible says he divided what was his of his living and he gave it to his son. People want what God can give them, but they don't want the father. It's God's air, it's God's food, it's God's water, it's God's time, it's God's world, but people don't want God. It's an interesting thing that we were put here on earth with a choice, and when God made man, he literally poured into him himself. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. God is a spirit, therefore if you're going to worship God, you must worship him in spirit and truth, and God poured his spirit into man. It says, he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Where'd that come from? The Father. And he put himself into mankind for him to live the best life he could ever live. But the Bible goes on to say in Psalm 14:1, it is the fool that has said in his own heart, hey, there is no God. They are corrupt. They've committed abominable deeds. There is no one that does good. We all get to the point in life where we choose sin. And this is the story of sin and grace. And it's a clear story so that even the hard-headed Pharisees and the rulers could get it. You know, some people that think they're so smart are so stupid. Do you get that? If you ask any of the guys that we work with, what I call myself, this is bad. Lord, forgive me this. And what was it? And the starving pygmies and where? It's somewhere, yeah. I tell them all the time I'm an idiot magnet. I mean, I can just drive to the car and go to the store, and who am I going to get that comes to the counter? I'm going to get the least informed, least trained goofball to wait on me. The next person in line gets the manager. I mean, it's like every single time. Well, this poor kid was an idiot. It was a hard reality. He got stuck out there partying and doing his thing. And he found out really quick that all that glitters is not gold. There's the reality of sin's pleasure. Let's talk about that for a minute. The word riotous living refers to a life totally given over to sinfulness and wickedness. In other words, when the boy left home, he left all his morality at home. And teenagers do that sometimes. Parents, don't give up on them. The Bible says if they were raised right, they'll come back. It'll be okay. Sometimes it doesn't work out that way, but most of the time it does. And so, parents, if you've got these kids that are rebellious, give me what you owe me, I'm leaving. Hang in there. The boy left home, and he left in such a way as to gratify every desire that he had, anything he wanted to do. Let me ask you this. You think he had a good time? Yeah. If you had all the money, you could buy all the rounds of drinks at the bar. Everybody's your buddy. It's pretty fun to do. Just go out and party, stay up as late as you want to stay up, sleep in the next morning, and do what you want to do. Is sin fun? Yes. Are having a lot of women, does that appeal to you guys? Yes. It's in our core, deep, this sexuality that we have. We want a woman, and men want a man. Is it fun? Yes. Y'all aren't listening to any part of this right here now. Y'all just tune that out, all out. That's bad stuff right there. He had a good time. But you got to remember Moses in Hebrews chapter 24 says, by faith Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Sin is fun. And it's always wrapped up in something attractive. The prodigal here in this story means wasteful. So we need to talk about this in just a minute about what sin really does. Sin dehumanizes people. The goodness which comes from God is stripped away by sin. Look at all the propaganda on TV. If you just watch the commercials, they make it look so great, especially all the commercials of people that are suffering from HIV. They make those commercials look great because I'm not going to change my lifestyle. Just give me some medicine so I can keep doing what I'm doing. Have you noticed it? It's really not that subtle. I mean, it's pretty obvious to see. Sin's tactics are not new. And let me show you why. If you look at history, you think about the Nazi propaganda that was put out there. They called the Jews the Untermenschen, subhumans. The Nazis called the Jews rats. The Hutus, involved in the Rwanda genocide, called the Tutsis cockroaches. Slave owners considered slaves to be subhuman chattel. During the colonial periods, native populations were referred to as savages. The untouchables of the Hindu caste system experienced a similar fate. To this day, racial slurs are a staple of racial bigotry. We could just go on and on and on of how people devalue their lives in sin, and it dehumanizes people. And such conceptualization is important and necessary to dehumanize people so that you can wrongly defend the evil actions against them, or is it so that you can excuse what you really want to do to them? Rape. Torture. Murder, decapitation, exploitation, merciless hatred, genocide.
You see, if you can just devalue someone's life, you can do anything to them you want to do to them, and it doesn't mean anything. Watch TV, what's going on in the Muslim states. Sin corrupts humanity because we are not meant to sin. When God created us, He created us to be like Him, to be sinless, but He gave us a choice. And you see, to be sinful violates your very purpose of why God put you here. He didn't put you here to be sinful. He didn't put you here to go and enjoy a far country. He put you here to live with Him in peace and love and a family and to live forever. Amen? That's why He put you here. God wants you to live, and you're not going to with sin in your life. It's an alienation from God. It corrupts our relationship with God. Sin is toxic. Why would a dog return to its own vomit and eat it again? And yet that's how God describes sin and the toxicity of it that ruins our lives. Sin corrupts our inner nature, our inner being, our identity from a very fundamental level. The Apostle Paul used the word hamartio or hamartano in the Greek, which means to miss the mark. The mark that we should be aiming at would be living in righteousness with God, in peace, loving humanity, loving our families, loving truth, loving justice, but we miss that mark because we aim at other things and we can't hit that bullseye anymore. The Apostle Paul said, everybody misses the mark. Everybody sins and falls short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. R.C. Sproul writes this, and this is a great quote. In the least transgression, I set myself above the authority of God, doing insult to His majesty, His holiness, and His sovereign right to govern me. Sin is a revolutionary act in which the sinner seeks to dispose God from His throne. Sin is a presumption of supreme arrogance, in that the creature vaults his own wisdom above that of the Creator. He challenges divine omnipotence with human importance and impotence. He seeks to usurp the rightful authority of the cosmic Lord. But I want you to notice in this passage, there's a really neat little phrase in here, for a season. You know, he didn't stay this way. Crazy out there living in the world. For a season. Seasons of life come and go and they change. And man, I remember those days when I was 13, 14, 18, 20. And you guys feel that when you're young. You've got this passion and you've got this desire to just experience the world and do your own thing. And that season was great. And you kids that are going off to college, you need to be free from your parents. You need to be free of someone watching over you all the time. But you don't need to be free from the morality that your parents are sending you off to school with. That's craziness. And you ought to be able to see that through this story. Retain the good things there, but enjoy this season of life because it's going to change. In fact, it'll change so badly that there'll be a time in your life you wish you could do that all over again. And you can't. And as seasons change, sometimes bad things come with those ill winds that blow in. Listen, this hard reality, it brought with this the reality of sin's price. I mean, it cost so much. He went to a far country, a land of wine, women, and song, and he came home from the land with weeping, sorrow, and worry. Sin brings a separation between you and God. It'll also separate you from your money. I mean, how long can you buy bar drinks and just keep putting it out there and say, it's on the house, ring the bell, ding, 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 ding. Everybody cheers, gets up, gets another round. And you can do that two or three nights, but I mean, isn't it expensive? Yeah, I'm speaking like I have a lot of experience. It's pretty expensive, isn't it? What are mixed drinks now? $10? $12? You got 60 people in a bar?
and you're going to spend $600 or $700 around? I mean, you better have some deep pockets. That's what was going on with this guy. And he was partying. He was having a good time. But it's separating him from his own money. It's separating him from his father. Sin also brings sorrow. He began to be in want. His life had turned upside down. The music stopped. His friends left. The money's gone. Now what? You see, I want to tell you that it pays big dividends to live for Jesus. But there are also dividends from sin. Sin pays, and sin will always pay off. Always. Here's what happens. Sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. Always. The deception that it's all going to be good and it's all going to be fun is a lie. Sin always pays off. Always. Galatians 6:9, Paul said, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we don't grow weary." Hang in there. And that's what the story is all about to these people that are lost in sin. Just hang in there. Come home. Get it back on right in your thinking. And so here's what happens in the story. Sin brings sadness to this boy. No one cares whether he lives or dies. He's lonely, he's hungry, and you know what? That's good. Good for you if you're miserable. The problem with people is that they party in so much, sometimes they never get to the miserable state. And I'm trying to teach someone to follow Jesus, and they're asking me about the life, and what do they have to give up, and what do they have to do? And I stop and I say, "You're just not miserable enough." "What do you mean?" "I mean, you've not enjoyed enough sin yet." "What?" When a man becomes miserable in the state that he's in, he'll get away from it, he'll change it, he'll leave it. And that is when people need to come to Jesus. What we've done for years and years and years is tell people, "You need to believe in Jesus and you need to be baptized." "Oh, I believe in Jesus." "Well, so does the devil and all his angels. They tremble." "Yeah, so we'll go in here and we'll get people dunked in the baptistry. Oh, we baptized another one today. We've got another member of our church. We got another Christian. We did our job. We're going to take my Acts 2:38 gun and carve a notch in it." You got to be old to get that one. While all the time they've never been miserable, they've never understood how bad it is that they need God in their life, and "I'll give up everything just to get back to Him." Man, that's where this boy was. I mean, it was a humble return for him because of what he went to. This humble return started with his realization of what's going on. And the Bible says he came to his senses, which means the word for insanity. Brody, have you ever been insane? Jesus, yeah, I've been there. And I had to come to my senses, and sometimes my dad helped me get there, right? Yep. So this boy is sitting out there, and he's so hungry, and he doesn't have any shoes anymore. I don't know what happened to his shoes. I mean, if you were going to go hitchhiking, what would you wear? Give me some good boots, right? He didn't have any shoes when he got home. He didn't have anything. He's laying out there in the mud. So the son's realization was, he came to himself and he thought, "This is insane. This is insane." He has a resolve. He makes up his mind to go home. He's tired, but he needs fellowship of the Father. He wants to go where he can be loved, fed, cared for. He wants to just go home. And I hope that your family has a great relationship, and that if anything ever happens to you, any tragedy falls on you, if you ever lose your way, that you could just say, "I just want to go home. Because at home, Mama will love me and feed me. Daddy will love me and he'll kiss me. And he'll hug me, and he'll tell me it's all right.
Let's do better, son. I'll help you. That's what we all want. When we're miserable, we're insane. But then we come to our senses, I just want to go home. He left saying, give me. He went home saying, make me. The Spirit shows us sometimes how miserable we are. And so let's talk about the Son's return. The Son's return is powerful because what happens is the Spirit of God convicts a man of his sin. John 6:44, and there's several other pages, places in the New Testament, that the work of the Spirit of God is to convict men of sin. In fact, I think I have it here. Let me pull this up. Listen to this. Nope, that's not it. When the Spirit of God convicts a man of sin, it gets deep within a man's soul, and the Spirit begins to put this work on you, this work of conviction that I would call it. And it calls you to your senses. It calls you to what the truth of God is like compared to all the lies that you've been listening to. Let's look at this next slide here, and I'll give you a copy of this if you want it. In the margin of my Bible, this is what I wrote down, okay? I started at verse 12, and these are the steps down into the pig pen in Luke 15. Self-will, pure selfishness, separation, sensuality, every sense in the body I'm going to fulfill. Spiritual destruction, self-abasement, and starvation. If you don't starve physically, you're going to starve spiritually, and you're going to starve emotionally when you finally end up in the pig pen. But then in the other column, when I got to verse 17, I started an arrow up out of the pig pen. There was a realization. There was a resolution. This is what I'll do. There was repentance. There's reconciliation when he comes home and to return. There was a reclothing, and there was rejoicing. How many of you are on the left side going down, and how many of you are on the right side going up? And I'm telling you, not all of mankind follows this little list that the Spirit gave us, but it is pretty dadgum right on. Amen. So when I learned that and I saw that, I thought, well, do I remember God's conviction in my own life? When was the point in time that I felt that conviction? And I ended up reuniting with my Father again. There's a few times in a man's life when he'll come to Jesus. You know what they are? Death of a parent. Sometimes death of a grandparent. Death of another family member. Divorce. Loss of a job. Bankruptcy. Now, let me tell you, you got friends walking all around you. They're in the pig pen. They're in a far country. You may be here slobbering in the slop with the pigs today, now. You're in a far country right here. There can be a happy reunion. He found a reception. Verse 20. He had a father that had been longing to see him, looking for him, wanting to live with his son in his return. He had this love and compassion and grace. The father wouldn't even allow the son to finish his little speech that he had rehearsed. Father, I've sinned against you in my sight. And blah, 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 blah. Hey, bring the fatted calf. He wouldn't even let him finish. Why? Why would the father not let him finish? You're right, Rachel. It didn't matter. It did not matter.
If you're one of these old hard-nosed guys that you've separated yourself from your children and they're not coming home until they do this and this and this and this, get over yourself. What your children need is for you to love them back home, to support them back into right thinking. They've been insane. Maybe you're the crazy one too that helped contribute to it. Love those children back into the right relationship that they need, that they want, they crave. And he found that restoration. The robe that was put on him, unbelievable. The robe was purity. Here stands a man with the rags of sin. He doesn't look like a child of the king, a child of a rich father. But the father orders the best of his robes to be brought and put on the son. The robe then, you see, would cover all the stains of his sin, all the dirt from the pig pen. You'd never know it because he's putting this robe on. Man, doesn't he look regal? In fact, that's his dad's robe, isn't it? He looks just like his dad. Look at him standing there together. You got the father, you got the son. They're royalty. He's just come out of the pig pen. The ring represented his privileges. With the robe came the ring. The ring was a symbol of authority and sonship. The ring, it gave you the right to speak to the father. You could come in before the head of the family if you had the son's ring on. You could just flash the ring, and you come, you have access to the father because you are special. With the ring, you could speak to the father and even question him in a respectful way. With the ring, you had everything that you had access to everything that the father owned because you had the ring. The one with the father's ring was in a position of great privilege. He could tell the workers what to do. He could represent the father in business details. You don't think that ring was important, and that dad knew it. And then he put shoes on his feet. Only the slaves went barefoot. But he didn't even ask to be a slave. There was one notch lower than a slave, a hired servant. And that's what he asked for. And I would imagine in the English vernacular, he would have put the word just in there. Probably it'd be like this. Father, just make me a hired servant. That's all. I just need to be in your presence. Maybe he used the word just when he left. Just give me everything you owe. Everything you owe me, just give it to me. But he comes home, wow, humble. The shoes represented his position as a son. What father would there be that wouldn't give his father shoes, especially if he was a rich man? And then he found great rejoicing in verse 23. The fattened calf was kept for special occasions, you know that. But instead, this kid wasted his life. He wasted his father's money. He wasted everything. And I would imagine the older brother is looking at this whole deal and saying, Dad's going to waste the fatted calf on this slob that's in the pig pen? What is wrong with Dad? We'll get to the brother next week. So look at these stories. The lost sheep ends with a party. The lost coin ends with a party. The lost son ends with a party. I love God. Isn't he great? I just think we need to learn how to party. You see, there's one way to party that's going to take you away from God. And then there's another way to party that God's going to be there dancing to. In fact, it's so strange that this guy, this dad, ran to meet the boy. Rich fathers don't run. He probably had to raise his thing up. You like that? He probably had to raise his cloak up so that he could run, going down the road so he doesn't trip. Can you imagine the sight? That's Prince Louis running down the road with his dress up. What is going on? You know something is way out of character, way out of place, but that's who God is. God could have had this boy stoned in the law of Moses. Listen to this. This is crazy. Oh, I'll just tell you. In the law of Moses, if a son talked to his father that way or treated his father with disrespect, the law of Moses says he should have been stoned. Do you think that the Pharisees and the scribes knew that law? So here Jesus is. He's so shrewd. Here Jesus is, and he tells them this story, okay? And the father, the great Jew, he's going to enact the law of Moses because that would make him a good Jew. That's not what God does. I asked one time why David was a man after God's own heart, after murdering and lusting and doing all the things he did. And I ask about this story, that being a faithful Jew, he should have followed the law of Moses. You know what Jim Woodruff told me? He said, that's because God loves mercy more than he loves justice. He didn't want to punish that boy, he just wanted him home. But you got to understand that the boy learned a whole lot of that when he came to his senses. And the father knew he'd been miserable. And Jesus did another thing in this story that's just crazy. What was the one thing you couldn't eat as a Jew? Huh? Poor people that couldn't have bacon. I'd never be a Jew. You couldn't have bacon. Couldn't have catfish. What is wrong? So here's what Jesus does. He says, here's a boy, and he went to this far country, and guess what? He's feeding pigs. And those Jewish leaders are going, what? A Jew boy feeding pigs? Jesus is in their face because they've got to understand how precious the lost are. Even Jews in a pig pen. Grace, you can't buy it. You can't earn it. You don't deserve it. You're unable to pay for it. You can't stop God's gift of it. You can't stop the beautification that comes with it. It cleanses you. It qualifies you. It emboldens you. And sometimes it shames you. Grace flows to the lowest part of me. It empowers me. Grace is given to the ill-deserving. It rejuvenates you. It increases your desire to please God. It gives you freedom. It gives you fire. It softens your heart. It nullifies the past. It prepares the future. It's scandalous. It's shocking. It's shareable. It soothes the suffering. Grace is love that cares, stoops, and rescues. It's God's best idea. It's extravagant demonstration. I deserve nothing. God gives me everything. If you're a vessel of grace, you can never pour it all out because God is filling it up all the time. You can't give away enough grace. You can't be gracious enough to people. Beauty without grace is like a hook without bait on it. We're all broken. We live mending, and grace is the glue. Your worst days are never so bad that you're beyond the reach of God's grace. And your best days are never so good that you're beyond the need of God's grace. Grace puts its hand on the boasting mouth and shuts it once and for all. Abounding sin is the terror of the world, but abounding grace is the hope of mankind. Have you ever experienced undeserved forgiveness? Are you lost in a far country? Do you need to come home? Two little short stories and we're done, and so's my voice. Looking out at the road rushing under my wheels, looking back at the years gone by, like so many summer fields, 65, I was 17, running up 101. I don't know where I'm running now. I'm just running on. Running on empty. Running blind. Running into the sun. But I'm running behind. You know who this is yet? I got you old people. Everyone I know, everywhere I go, people need some reason to believe. I don't know about anyone but me. If it takes all night, that'll be all right. If I can get you to smile before I leave. Looking out at the road, rushing under my wheels, I don't know how to tell you just how crazy this feels. Look around for the friends that I used to turn to, and they pull me through. Looking into their eyes, I see them running too. Running on empty, running blind, running into the sun, I'm running behind. Honey, you really tempt me. I know the way you look, so kind. I'd love to stick around, but I'm running behind. Running on empty, running blind, running into the sun, I'm running behind. There's a guy that wrote some books back in 1919. His name was William E. Barton. And he wrote these little books that were little stories. And he compiled them and he wrote as if he was Sophid the Sage. Okay? And in 1965, William Barton's son began to take some of these writings and he put them into this little book, which I think was copyrighted in 1965. It's been out of print 30 years. I have tape all over it. So these little stories are about a sage, Sophid, who's a preacher, and has a sweet wife named Keturah, and they live next to the church building. All right, and that's the setup. This little story is called The River Current. We sailed on the river, I and Keturah, yea, upon two rivers, and even three. For we entered into a ship and sailed down the Mississippi and up the Ohio, and then up the Tennessee. We sailed for 8 days, and we sailed for 1,000 miles, and the waters in all these rivers were high, and the current was swift. And we ascended the Tennessee slowly by reason of the current. And I grew anxious, for I must return the next Sabbath, and on that Sabbath, I've already been one Sabbath away. And the captain spake to me, saying, "Fear not, we ascend slowly, but we shall go down the river like a bat escaping out of perdition." You'll get that. And that was the way we came down, and we neared the city of the name of whereof was Paducah, where three great rivers meet, even the Tennessee and the Cumberland and the Ohio. I and Keturah, we were to leave the boat there at that place. And the captain came to me and he said, "Behold, I was mistaken. We shall not hardly make thy train." And I said, "Behold, how fast we go, and Paducah is not but 20 miles away." And he said, "Paducah is indeed but 20 miles away, but we are not going fast. We are burning just as much coal, and the wheels are going around just as fast, but we are no longer in the waters of the Tennessee, but in the backwaters of the Ohio. For the Ohio is rising more rapidly than the Tennessee, wherefore the mighty current that bore us down hath ceased, and a mightier current, although unseen, doth hold us back." And I thought of the men who begin their religious life with a strong current of love and devotion, moving with their will and mightily sweeping them forward toward their desired haven, but also of the unseen currents of worldliness that imperceptibly retard them and even cause them to drift another way. And on the Sabbath, I stood before my congregation and I said, "O men and women, think not, because the wheels still go around, and thou art puffing and making much smoke, that thou shalt surely go to heaven. Behold, there's an undertow and a mighty inflooding that may hold thee back, or even drift thee whither thou wouldst not go. These things I spake on the Sabbath, because in spite of the backwater, I and Keturah, we got there." And I think you'll get there. I believe that God will convict you and that grace will be your champion. and God is waiting for you. He's looking. The Father never stopped staring down that road, looking for that Son. Let's stand and sing.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your Son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 and again and again. Oh, oh. And I feel this rush deep in my chest. Your mercy is calling out. Just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 and again and again. Oh, 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 and again and again.
Amen. You can be seated.
How we see things.
Yeah, what? Oh, yeah, what?
fine. We just want to remind you of something about us.
We noticed everything.
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 I noticed when you eat in the living room.
I noticed when you pick your nose in the car.
I noticed you reading your Bible every morning before breakfast.
I noticed when you help me pick up my dollies.
I noticed when you have a hard day at work.
I noticed the ice cream disappeared after bedtime last night.
I noticed you give Mom a kiss when you come home every day.
I noticed you're always taking care of me.
And each other.
How do you think we'll learn to treat our families?
And since we know that you've got a lot on your mind,
we'll keep this simple.
Healthy marriage.
Healthy family.
Healthy kids.
Morning, church.
Good morning.
Or almost good afternoon. I always feel like I have to bend over in this. So I want to put it right up here so I can stand up straight. Thank you for being here with us today. Derek, thank you for the message. And Amy, thank you for leading us in worship. It takes all of us to do this well. And it takes His presence to bless it all. And the Holy Spirit here with us to encourage us and to help us encourage one another and point us in the right direction. So thank you very much. You got to witness two of my favorite things today. Celebrating new life. Don't you guys love babies? I love babies. And then celebrating true life. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. So any day you get to celebrate both of those starts off as a good day, right? Yeah. Amen. And families, We love you, families of the two babies. We love you, and we're here to support you. If you need any assistance at all in helping raising that child up and to know Jesus, we're here for you to point you to Jesus. So, and the church says amen on that, I know. I want to briefly, we're going to run through this real quick. This is a care package that some of our members here at church put together on Wednesday night. So if you were involved in this, I thank you. We want to give you a round of applause for your efforts. We had several people on Wednesday night that showed up to put these together. We have people in our community that are in need. For whatever reason, they are homeless. And doesn't matter what the reason is, they are hurting right now, and they are in need. And what does Jesus tell us to do when we see someone in need? We are to serve, to love, to help, right? So we have a few more of these packages right here. We want you, on your way out, if you feel led to pick one of these up, stick them in your car. And if you run across someone that's hurting, that needs to know that someone cares and loves for them, give them one of these packages. Sound good? I think we've got maybe 10 or 12 of them left back there. We made a whole bunch, but most people took them already. Next week on Wednesday night, because we did that care package this last Wednesday night, this Wednesday night we are going to have some fun. We're going to have a cornhole tournament. That's right. And so Kim's already put the challenge out there. She thinks she's going to win. So we're going to do that on Wednesday night starting at 6:30. So we come on out. It doesn't matter if you're good at the game or not. I need somebody to beat. So if you're terrible, we'll find a place for you, okay? You'll be first round. You're facing me. So, yeah, I bet. So also, if you have some extra cornhole boards along with those bean bags as well, bring them. I know we've got at least three sets right now. We're going to try to get several of them going at one time. So join us for that. And then also, we need help with jam time on Sunday mornings for the next, I guess, from now until, or from September to December. We have a sign-up sheet in the back, and we need help with that. Paula needs help with that. She's been doing that for quite a while now. We have jam time already has been taken care of for the younger kids. This is for the I don't even know the age groups, but it's for the older jam time kids. So rather than just send you out there to sign up, at least I want to see at least two people that can help us right here, so I'll know that this time was effective. Anybody can help us at any time.